I want to begin by going through our Advent candles here. You know, the candles are arranged in a circle with no beginning and no end. It's a symbol of endless love and faithfulness. Out of darkness, light shines, pointing us to hope in Jesus, who came to overcome the darkness of this world and to be our light in the world to come. 3 weeks ago, we lit the prophecy candle and remembered those who first spoke the promise of the coming Christ child. Two weeks ago, we lit the Bethlehem candle, a symbol of the preparations being made to receive and cradle the Christ child. Last week, we lit the shepherd's candle, remembering the first in a long line of people who joyfully shared the good news of the Savior's birth. And today is the fourth candle, and it's the angel's candle. It reminds us of the hope fulfilled in the first coming of our Savior and our continuing hope as we anticipate His coming again. Luke 2, 8 through 14. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. I invite you to stand with us this morning as we'll sing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Sure. welcome, new star. You're looking nice and bright this evening.
Thank you, old star. I've been working on my shininess.
Good job. And this is a great night for all of us to look our best.
Why is that?
Because it's Christmas.
Yeah. What's Christmas?
You don't know about Christmas? Oh, that's right. You're a brand new star. This is your very first Christmas.
Yes. Is it your first Christmas, too?
Oh, no. I've seen over 2,000 of them.
Wow, 2,000. Is that a lot?
Oh, yes, it is. In fact, I am old enough to tell you about the very first Christmas, and I can explain why we still celebrate it even after all these years.
Oh, please do. I want to hear all about it.
Okay, to start with, we have to go back before the first Christmas and visit a little place called Nazareth.
Is Nazareth a place in the sky? You know, up in space?
No, it's a place down on Earth, on that little bitty planet down there.
Do you mean the one over there by Jupiter?
No, the one a little further to the right.
Do you mean Pluto? I didn't think it was still a planet.
No, not Pluto. To the right, your other right.
You mean the little blue and green one there between Mars and Venus?
Exactly. And look, right over there, that is the town of Nazareth.
Oh, who's that pretty lady?
That's Mary. She is virgin, and she is pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. Joseph is a carpenter. He is also a righteous man.
What's he doing?
Building something. Carpenters always build something.
I hope it's a cradle.
I think you're getting ahead of our story.
Who's that other guy? He's all shiny like us.
That's Gabriel. He's an angel. He has come to talk to Mary. Let's listen.
Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with a child and give him the name Jesus, for he will save people from their sins.
How will this be, since I am a virgin?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One will be born. Even Elizabeth is going to have a child in her old age, for nothing is impossible with God.
I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said.
What did all that mean?
The angel told Mary that she is going to have a baby who will be the Son of God.
And what did Mary say?
She said yes.
Oh, good. Now what? I like Mary. She seems really nice.
Oh, she is. After the angel left her, Mary hurried to visit her cousin Elizabeth. When Mary arrived, she found out that things were just like the angel had told her.
Mary seems really happy to see Elizabeth. And just think, Elizabeth was going to have a baby in her old age. It was a miracle.
Yes, and Mary wasn't the only one who was happy. Elizabeth was happy too. Listen to what she said to Mary.
Blessed among women, blessed the child you will bear. Why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me?
My soul glorifies the Lord, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed.
Mary stayed with Elizabeth for a long visit and then returned home to Nazareth. But by now it's more obvious that she is going to have a baby.
Uh-oh, what did Joseph say?
Well, Joseph knew the baby wasn't his, but since Joseph was a righteous man, he decided to put Mary away privately. But after he had considered these things, God sent an angel to speak to him in a dream.
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, for he shall save people from their sins.
All of this was done in fulfillment of the ancient prophecy. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. Oh, and the name Emmanuel means God with us.
Wow, that's a great name. What did Joseph do when he woke up?
He did just what the angel had told him to do.
Okay, so what happened next?
Next, there was a little drama that went in on Rome. Caesar, the Roman ruler, ordered that everyone had to be counted.
Why would he do that?
Something about taxes, whatever those are. But in order to be counted, everyone had to go back to their family's hometown.
Sort of like a family reunion.
A little bit, but without the games or the potato salad.
That's too bad. I love potato salad. Did they have cookies? I love cookies, too.
I don't think so.
Then it really wasn't much like a family reunion at all.
No. In fact, for Mary and Joseph, it was a pretty long and difficult trip, especially since Mary was expecting a baby.
Where did they have to go?
They went to a little town called Bethlehem.
Do you mean that little bitty town over there in the middle of nowhere?
That's the one. It was the birthplace of Joseph's ancestor, King David.
Wait a minute. Bethlehem isn't that the one they sing about, the one they call a little town of Bethlehem.
Yes!
I really like that song. They even sing about how the silent stars go by.
Listen, I think someone's going to sing it now. No tree on the first Christmas, but there was a star.
Where?
We're getting there. First, we have to hear more about Mary and Joseph.
Okay.
So, Joseph went to Bethlehem to be counted, and Mary went with him.
Look, Mary and Joseph have arrived in Bethlehem. I hope they have somewhere nice to stay. Mary looks very tired.
You're right, but there was no room for them in the inn, so Mary and Joseph stayed in the stable.
A stable? Do you mean like for cows and horses and goats and sheep and...
Yep. Mary and Joseph stayed in a humble stable. There Mary had her baby and she wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in the manger.
Why did they put the baby in a manger?
It was probably the safest and best place they had for him. I'm sure that Joseph lined it with fresh new hay and stood watch over Mary and the baby during the night.
What did they name the baby?
They named him Jesus, which means the Lord saves. And now, for the first time up in the sky, there was a new star announcing the birth of the Messiah.
Look, I think they're going to sing again.
They do that a lot at Christmas time. You get used to it.
Thank you. night, there's a new star in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. There's a new star shining in the sky tonight, and it's leading wise men to the holy light. There's a new star in the sky.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
There's a new star shining in the sky tonight, and it's leading wise men to the holy light. There's a new star in the sky. Message is clear to all those far and near, for it's telling the world the Messiah is here.
The Messiah is here.
There's a new star in the sky. There's a new star in the sky.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
Wow, that was a really great song. Just think, a new star in the sky. How wonderful. How glorious. No one on earth could have missed that.
It's amazing that not only did people miss the Messiah then, but that they still miss him today. Maybe it's because they aren't really looking for the Messiah. But God didn't rely on a single new star to announce the birth of his son. He also sent an angel to tell a group of shepherds all about it. Of course, it really frightened the shepherds to suddenly see an angel.
Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. For this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. For
suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth,
goodwill
towards men.
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, so they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told of them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Thank you.
That's the story of the first Christmas and the star?
Yes, but there's more to the story. Look, over there in the east.
Who are those guys?
They are three wise men, but they can tell us themselves.
We begin well.
Bearing gifts, we travel afar.
The Odin Fountain Moor and Mountain following yonder star.
Wait a minute. What are they saying?
It's from an old song about the three wise men. They're saying that they're three kings from the east and that they've traveled a long way to get here.
Oh, I get it. And they saw a new star and they followed it because they were wise enough to know that it meant the Savior has been born.
That's right. Listen, I think they're going to sing about it. The gifts are for the baby Jesus. They are gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold because Jesus is the king, frankincense because he is the high priest, and myrrh because of his sacrifice.
Hey, where are they going? Bethlehem's over there. Hey, fellas, you're going the wrong way. The baby's over there.
They're going to Jerusalem, to the palace, to look for the king of the Jews.
But why? The baby was born in Bethlehem, over there. He was born in a stable.
They went looking for the baby king in a palace, but they didn't find him there.
Who did they find?
Well, unfortunately, they met an evil man named Herod, who was the local ruler.
Where's the one? Where's the baby born? King of the Jews.
We saw the star in the east.
And we have come to worship him.
When Herod heard all of this, he was greatly distressed, and all of Jerusalem with him. He called in the Jewish chief priests and the teachers of law and asked them where the Messiah was to be born.
This is what the prophet has written, "But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel."
Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. When you find him, come and tell me so that I may come and worship him too.
So the wise men went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they gave him their gifts and went back to their own countries. But having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they went home a different way.
Why didn't they go back to see Herod?
Because Herod didn't really want to worship Jesus. He wanted to destroy him.
That's horrible.
Yes, it was.
What happened to baby Jesus?
An angel was sent to warn Joseph in a dream to take his family away to Egypt, where they would be safe. They escaped into the night before Herod found them.
That's wonderful. Is that the whole story?
There is a little more. When it was safe to return, the child Jesus and his family traveled back to Nazareth where he was raised. Jesus was the Son of God, and he did all of the things that were prophesied about him. He lived a perfect life and died on a cross for all sin and rose again and lived forever. Now he sits at the right hand of God the Father, and one day he will come to judge the world.
That's amazing. And how do you know all this?
Oh, I saw it all from up here in the sky. For you see, I am the new star that appeared that night.
Really? You are the new star, but you're so old.
So is the story, over 2,000 years old. But it is still as true today as it was in the very first Christmas. And that's why we still celebrate Christmas today.
That's amazing. Thank you for telling me the story. I think I'll shine a little brighter now that I know all this. Okay, so now what?
Looks like it's time for another song.
And cookies? I love cookies.
Yes, yes, we'll get you some cookies. Come on.
Thank you. Abby, twice. That was awesome. Well, good job, young people. Everybody did such a good job on their parts, and your acting was superb. I really like all the personality that we saw and all of that. And we're going to have you come up in just a minute and have everybody congratulate you in just a few minutes, okay? But good job. We're very proud of you. To piggyback on what they have said here this morning, they did a great job presenting the Christmas account and what happened on that day over 2,000 years ago. I want to read a passage from the scripture to you that they were referencing and that they were demonstrating to us. Matthew 1:21 says, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." You know, if God would have looked down on earth and said, those people, they need better policies, he would have sent a politician. If God would have looked down, or maybe the stars would have looked down on the earth and decided that they needed better education, God would have sent us an educator. If he had decided that what we really need help with was our finances, he would have sent some guru in the financial field to help us out with that. You know, sometimes we may look around and say, we need better organization, but that's not what God thought, because if he would have thought we needed more organization, he would have sent an administrator. Or maybe he could have looked down and said, you know what, we just need to clean them up a little bit, make them a little bit better, and renovate them. If that would have been the case, God would have sent a life coach. But God sent none of those. God knew that the greatest need that you and I have, and everybody who's ever lived that we've had, is forgiveness. And so God sent a Savior. Jesus came to save his people from their sins. You and I, born into this world as sinners. And the good news is only good news if there's bad things going on. You never run into a great situation and say, I have good news. You always look for good news, and good news is good news when bad things are going on. And this bad thing, this horrific thing, this horrible thing is not just their problem or somebody else's problem. It's my problem and your problem. It's sin. And we're all born sinners. We all choose to sin. And by nature, we are sinners in this world. And so what did we need the most? We needed forgiveness. So God sent a Savior. Now, no matter what problem you brought into the room this morning, your greatest need is forgiveness. And that's why Jesus came for you. And it doesn't matter who you are today. Maybe you've been in church your whole life, but you've never made it personal. You've never personally trusted Jesus as your Savior. He came for you. Maybe you're not around church much, but you know in your heart of hearts that you're a sinner and you need a Savior. Jesus came for you. There's no sinner that's so bad that Jesus didn't come to save, and he's not able to save. Just a few verses down there in Matthew 1, verses 22 and 23, it says, "Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us." You know, this morning, we reflect on that first Christmas when Jesus Christ came. And we all fill our lives with things. We want others with us that we think are going to bring us satisfaction. But ultimately, other people can't do that for us. We bring other things into our life to be with us. We bring things to enter life with us, like money and experiences and, you know, a better fit or a better job, or maybe even bettering ourselves with self-care and taking care of ourselves and making life so comfortable that we couldn't want anything. We bring all these things to be with us, but what you and I need desperately is God. And he's not up in heaven looking down from afar saying, man, I hope they figure it all out. Or, you know, I hope that they get my message. No, he came to personally be with us. That's what Emmanuel means, God with us. And if you and I could understand that God with us is our greatest need and will actually satisfy us, it would change our life. Emmanuel is a beautiful word. We only seem to bring it up at Christmas, but we need Emmanuel every single day. And so I hope that what the children have said today and what the scripture has given will inspire your heart to look to Jesus. I'm going to ask Gary to come for a second. He's going to play a familiar tune at Christmas time for us. And the song is, O Come All Ye Faithful. And I want you to think about this as he plays. We sing that song, and that song has been written to the faithful masses of Christ followers at Christmas time to come and adore him and to worship him. Oh, come, let us adore him. And we enjoy that. And we at Christmas time, we look forward to the adoring of Jesus. But let me ask you this morning, maybe you came in the room today and you would say, I don't qualify as faithful right now. The song says, oh, come all you faithful, and we get dressed up and we come to church and we got to look our best because it's church and we want everybody to look around and say, well, you know, we got it going on and we got it all together. But the fact of the matter is every single one of us came in this morning and we don't have it all together. We're messy people. Our lives in some area are not how we would desire them to be, if we're just going to be honest this morning. We can look at our lives and we can say, there's something missing. And like I said, we try to fill it with. And those things and those people are not going to satisfy us. God designed our soul. God designed your soul to only be satisfied with him. In him only. And so as we think about the faithful who come, maybe you'd say, man, I'm anything but faithful today. My life is a mess, or I've got things going on that nobody else knows about except for me and God, and I'm not sure that I'm invited. No. Jesus came for the whole world. In fact, when those shepherds received that message from the angels that first Christmas, you know what they said? We bring good tidings, good news of great joy, which shall be to all people. No matter where you're at today, no matter where you've been, no matter what's going on in your life, what you've been hiding or just showing, it doesn't matter. He came for you. This news is for you. You are all people. You are all people. He came for you. This news is for you. And so if you would, right where you're at, just bow your head. If I could have everybody cooperate with us, just bow your head right where you are. And if you would just, I mean, you're here already, right? You've seen a beautiful and a fun and a cute depiction from the Word of God. And we're here in this moment, so take advantage of it. Just still your heart, still your mind, and concentrate alone on the Lord. For some of us, it's been a while since we've done that, and that's okay. You're all invited to come to him. He's turning nobody away. He said he's not going to cast anybody out who comes to him. So you just come to him this morning and level with him. Admit to him the things, the people, the activities that you are bringing into your life to try to satisfy that whatever it is that you can't seem to satisfy. And it never gets better, and it only gets worse because we're using other things to be with us instead of inviting Emmanuel to come into our life. and maybe to wreck us and maybe to break us down and rip away our identity and rip away what makes us comfortable and rip away who we've built up as who we are. Maybe we need him to come in and just change everything up. Would you give him access to do that today? Would you just give God the keys to your heart and your life? Maybe you say, I'm not ready for that step, man. I this is a lot. Let me ask you this question then. Would you at least consider opening yourself up to hearing from him? Maybe you'd listen to the Bible on your phone app, or you'd read some scripture each day and just say, okay, Lord, what I'm doing isn't working, so I need you to come into my heart and do something. And just you and God, let him in. Are you willing to do that? Maybe you say, look, man, I'm not even there. I'm kind of closed off. I've got figured out what I've got in my life. I'm kind of set in my ways. I've made my choices. Here's the best part. A God who did something as radical as place his son in the womb of a virgin and let himself become a man and lived in this world and died in this world and rose from the dead. A God who's willing to do something that radical is willing to come into your life even when you think you're not ready. There were so many people who weren't ready that first Christmas. And yet he came. Because he loves you. And he's not going to give up. Would you at least be open to hearing from him? I'm going to pray for us this morning. So please keep your head bowed. And if you wouldn't mind just closing your eyes, so it's a very private moment with you and God, and I'm going to pray for you this morning. And when I say amen, I would appreciate it if you'd keep your head bowed and your eyes closed, because I'm going to ask a question, not for my benefit, but for yours, okay? So let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this morning and for what these young people have brought before us. Lord, it was so cute and adorable and touching and warm. And we loved every second of it. And yet, Lord, you have used children, the most innocent among us, to bring a powerful reminder. And so, Lord, don't let us pass that part up. Love was on display this morning, a love that goes beyond our understanding, that shook up the whole world 2,000 years ago because you love us. And so, Lord, I pray for those in the room this morning who are far away from you, and they come in today and they would admit that they're not who would be considered faithful. They're far away. But, Lord, they know deep down, they know they need you. They just don't have it in them right now to come out and say it. Lord, I pray that you would continue to work on their heart, soften their heart, and get them to that place where they're ready for you, Lord. Please have mercy on them. I know that, Lord, there's been times in my life when I've strayed, and I thank you that you did not give up, and I thank you that you kept pursuing me. Even when I didn't think I wanted it, you kept pursuing me, and I thank you for that. And I pray that for these as well. And Lord, we ask for those who are here today who are at least open to hearing from you. I pray that in the coming days and weeks, as they begin to walk through your word, that you would speak to their heart and change their heart. And Lord, for those who came this morning saying, Lord, thank you, and I love you, and I want more of your presence in my life, I pray that you would be full on Emmanuel. Bless them this way, Lord. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Now please keep your head bowed and your eyes closed. This is for nobody's benefit but you, because I'm not even going to look, okay? There's not a soul in the room looking right now. there ought not be. So we're asking for every head to be bowed and every eye to be closed. And so I'm just going to ask between you and God to raise your hand if you came in the room this morning and you're like, I'm pretty far from God and I'm not sure I'm ready yet. As a testimony of just being willing to move a little bit, to admit that, just slip your hand up and put it right back. I'm telling you, nobody's looking, not even me. This is for your benefit, not mine or anybody else's. Just put your hand up and right back down that says, I'm not even sure I'm ready for that yet. Because God sees this. I know he sees your heart, but this is for you. This is the first step of admitting, okay? So one more time. I came in today, I'm pretty far, I'm not even sure I'm ready for that. Just slip your hand up and right back down. Okay? Now, if you're here today and you say, you know what, I'm at least open to hearing from God. Lord, here's my hand, just put your hand up and right back down. I'm at least open to hearing from you. Would you speak to me? Okay, put your hand up right back down. You and God know that it's between you and him. And now you need to take a step. You took that first step of admitting it in your heart and raising your hand. Now, in the next days, starting today, get that Bible out. Open up a Bible app and get into the Word of God. Let him have access to your heart. And again, nobody's looking, but if you're here today and you say, Lord, of course I'm not perfect. I don't have it all figured out, but I want more of you. I need more of you. Would you just slip your hand up today? Right up and right back down. Again, nobody's looking, not even me. This is for your benefit, to admit to God, here's where I am. Now that's your first step. And so how are you going to practically get more of God into your life? Talk to him about that in the days to come. Amen. Thank you. You may look up. Okay, so what I'd like to do as we dismiss is I would like to have, if it's okay with our director, in just a minute we'll have the kids come up right here in the front, down on the bottom, and we'll move the microphones out of the way, and I want everybody to come by and just tell them how good of a job they did. And, I think we underestimate the power of the innocent child giving a powerful message like the gospel. And I hope what you know you've seen today is not just cute and adorable, but it's young people taking the word of God and giving it to who will ever hear it. That's important. And I'm thankful for all the parents and grandparents who've included their children in this today, because you're teaching them that spreading the gospel is an important thing. Great job. Great job. And so we're going to have them come up in just a minute, but I want to thank a few people first. Of course, our director, Abby Graver. Abby's a perfect mix of Mike and Angie. I don't know how else to say it. She really is. She's a perfect mix of them. Of all their good traits, she's a perfect mix of those things. I mean that. And she does a great job with anything that comes her way. And this program today just shows her heart for the Lord and for the young people and for the gospel. So Abby, great job. Thank you. Also for her helpers, we have Trisha and Loretta and Angie, who helped out there. Her crew, if you will. And then we have the behind-the-scenes people. We've got our sound man, Mr. Jeff. And on the slides, Lauren. And so all that's important. All that's important. If we don't have that, everybody's looking around saying, what in the world's going on? But man, they didn't miss a beat. We're thankful for that. And then, of course, our film crew, Fresh Focus Marketing. From Holland Solutions, check them out online. Well, they'll give you a discount. Just mention Phil, and they'll give you a discount. I'm kidding. But Jeremy and Steven for getting this all on film for us. And I know our team upstairs working on it too, our video team upstairs, so we can send these out to our shut-ins and such. So thank you, everybody, for all your involvement in this. All right, kids, come on up. And as they're coming, I want to let you know, on your way out today, we've got some people standing by. They look menacing, but they're really nice guys, and they're going to give you candy on your way out. So it's a big prize there, candy for everyone. All right, kids, now I know this is your spot for the play, but I want everybody down here on this level here where I'm at, and spread out single file. All right? Because everybody's going to come by and tell you a good job. Luke, come on down, bud. Come on over here, buddy. There you go. Awesome. Good job. Man, these kids did a great job. All right. So, everybody, let's stand together. And, oh, it's a Christmas miracle. It's snow. And, woo, snow. All right. I just lost the kids. But Merry Christmas. Come on by and say hello to the kids.